Picture this. It's 2 a.m. and you're lying in bed, exhausted but wide awake. Your body feels heavy, but your mind is racing through tomorrow's to-do list, replaying that awkward conversation from 3 years ago, or worrying about whether or not you'll be able to function tomorrow. If this sounds familiar, you're not alone. But to understand why this happens and how to fix it, we need to look at what is actually happening in your brain during these sleepless nights. I'm Dr. Tracey Marks, a psychiatrist, and I make mental health education videos. We've been talking about sleep and its essential role in building resilience. Today, we're looking at what actually happens in the brain when you can't sleep, and more importantly, what you can do about it. Your ability to fall asleep isn't as simple as just being tired. It's actually controlled by two separate systems in your brain, your sleep drive and your wake drive. Think of it like a car with both an accelerator and a brake. Your sleep drive is like a pressure that builds up the longer you're awake, and that's controlled by a chemical called adenosine. Your neurons produce adenosine as a waste product of normal cell function. As adenosine accumulates in your brain throughout the day, it gradually makes you feel sleepier. And this is why you might feel that overwhelming urge to nap after being awake for many hours. Your adenosine levels are peaking. But here's the thing. Your wake drive can override this system, and it does so through several sophisticated mechanisms. This alerting system is primarily controlled by a region in your brain called the lateral hypothalamus, which produces a stimulating chemical called orexin. Think of orexin as your brain's natural caffeine. When orexin-producing neurons are active, they trigger a cascade of other wake-promoting chemicals like norepinephrine, acetylcholine, and histamine. And this is the same histamine that anti-allergy medications block, which explains why some allergy medications make you drowsy. These two systems, sleep drive and wake drive, are normally synchronized with your circadian rhythm, your internal 24-hour clock. But various factors can throw this delicate balance off, and that's when sleep problems begin. One of the most common disruptors of this system is hyperarousal, when your brain gets stuck in a state of heightened alertness. Let's look at what this actually means in the brain. When you're lying in bed worrying about that presentation tomorrow, your amygdala, part of the brain's emotional processing center, flags these thoughts as potential threats. This triggers your hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, or HPA axis for short, to release stress hormones like cortisol and adrenaline. These hormones are great when you need to fight or flee from danger, but they're not so helpful when you're trying to sleep. This stress response does several things. It increases your heart rate, raises your body temperature, and most importantly, it signals to those orexin-producing neurons that we talked about earlier to keep firing. It's like your brain saying, danger, we better stay awake here and deal with this, even though the danger is just tomorrow's meeting. Have you ever noticed that when you push through your tiredness, maybe to finish a project or watch another episode on television, you suddenly feel wide awake? This is called the second wind phenomenon, and it's a perfect example of how our brain's ancient survival mechanisms can work against us in the modern world. Here's what's happening. When you ignore your initial wave of sleepiness, your brain interprets this as a signal that you must stay awake for something important. In our evolutionary past, this would have been critical for survival. Imagine needing to stay alert to watch for predators. Your brain responds by suppressing sleep signals and ramping up arousal systems. It releases a cocktail of wake-promoting chemicals, including orexin, cortisol, and adrenaline. And this is why you might feel physically tired, but mentally wired. Modern technology makes this problem even worse in multiple ways. Yes, there's the blue light from our devices that suppresses melatonin production, and that's the chemical that helps regulate your sleep-wake cycle. But it's actually more complex than just light exposure. The constant stream of novel information from social media, news, or work emails keeps your brain in active learning and processing. Your brain's reward system releases dopamine with each new piece of information, each notification, each response to an email. And this creates a subtle but powerful form of arousal that can override your natural sleep signals. This brings us to one of the most frustrating aspects of sleep problems, the vicious cycle of sleep anxiety. When you've had a few bad nights of sleep, your brain starts to form new associations. Your bed, instead of triggering relaxation, becomes associated with frustration and anxiety. And this happens through a process called classical conditioning, the same principle that made Pavlov's dog salivate at the sound of a bell. So as bedtime approaches, your anxiety about sleep triggers the release of stress hormones. These hormones activate your sympathetic nervous system, your fight or flight response. This increased arousal makes it harder to fall asleep, which confirms your fears about not being able to fall asleep, which creates more anxiety the next night. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy powered by your brain's own chemistry. But here's the good news. Understanding these brain mechanisms gives us specific ways to break the cycle. And so let's talk about some of these brain-based solutions. First, work with your brain's natural rhythms, not against them. Your sleep drive is typically strongest about 7 to 8 hours after you wake up. That's why you might feel that afternoon slump, which has less to do with eating a huge lunch and more about your body's natural rhythm. You have another strong sleep drive about 14 to 16 hours after waking. When you feel that evening wave of sleepiness, that's your sleep drive at its optimal point. Missing this window can trigger that second wave that we talked about. Second thing, if you find yourself in that hyper-aroused state, trying to force sleep will usually backfire. Instead, try what sleep scientists called paradoxical intention. Rather than attempting to make yourself fall asleep, which creates performance anxiety, try to stay awake while doing something boring. This reduces the pressure to fall asleep and, paradoxically, even makes it easier to drift off. Third thing, manage your brain's stress response system actively. Deep breathing exercises can activate your parasympathetic nervous system, your body's rest and digest mode. Here's a specific technique that works with your brain's natural relaxation response. Breathe in for a count of four, hold for four, breathe out for four, and then hold for four. This pattern, known as box breathing, can help lower stress levels and reduce autonomic arousal. In a previous video, I talked about the 4-7-8 pattern and how it's recommended for sleep due to the longer exhale. Box breathing is helpful for general anxiety or when you're feeling stressed, but you want to maintain a balanced, calm state of alertness rather than induced drowsiness. Box breathing simplicity makes it accessible and effective for regular practice, potentially improving your overall stress response over time. When should you seek professional help? If you're experiencing chronic insomnia, which is difficulty sleeping for at least 3 nights per week, for at least 3 months or more, it's time to talk to a healthcare provider. And watch for these specific signs of insomnia: taking more than 30 minutes to fall asleep regularly, waking up multiple times during the night, and staying awake for more than 20 minutes after you wake up, feeling unrefreshed despite adequate time in your bed, and experiencing significant daytime impairment. There are effective treatments available, including cognitive behavior therapy for insomnia, which works by addressing both the behavioral and cognitive aspects of sleep problems. It also helps retrain your brain's sleep associations and manages the anxiety that often accompanies sleep difficulties. Occasional sleep difficulties are normal, but chronic sleep problems can significantly impact your resilience and overall mental health. The key is understanding that sleep or getting sleep is not just about being tired. It's about your brain's complex sleep-wake systems and learning to work with them and not against them. In our next video, we'll explore another fascinating aspect of sleep, the hidden power of dreams and what they tell us about our mental health. If you haven't already, be sure to subscribe so that you don't miss it. Thanks for watching today. See you next time.